Now, I would like to invite Professor Pier Giorgio Odifredi.
Hello.
From Università di Torino.
Yes.
Buon pomeriggio, professore. Allora, cominciamo, prego.
Okay. I just have to share my screen.
The topic is the Gelderland religion. So.
Okay, very good. So first of all, just a quick comment on the previous lecture. The right question should be, where the hell is paradise? together the two things. And also, you know, on a more serious level, there is a I think a book by Cardinal Bellarmino of Galilean memory that actually asked himself the question. It was not really the question of where paradise was, but where was the body of Jesus Christ after the ascension on heaven? And he said that it was just below the sphere of the fixed stars. Now, of course, you know, it would be difficult to place that sphere in modern cosmology. So, but anyway, you know, it's interesting that some cardinals, you know, even at the Inquisition, asked the question. So now, instead, I want to share my. Let me see if I can do it. Share the screen. Yes. What happens here? Just okay. A moment. I have to.
I have to wait a while, and it should work.
Okay. Here it is. Let me see if you see it.
Not yet, but okay, something happens. Okay,
can you see it?
Yes, it's okay.
Okay, very good. So, appropriately, since today is the 14th of January, so it's the anniversary of Gödel's death, so we're going to talk about Gödel and God. And of course, you know, this is a play on word. As you noticed, the first syllable, so to speak, of the word, of the name Gödel, is God. And the last syllable is El, which is God in Hebrew. So in a sense, you know, there was something in the name of Gödel that had to do with God, both in the English and the Hebrew connection. So quickly, in 20 minutes, I will try to prove the existence of God. Of course, you know, this is a proof that was given by Gödel. And first of all, a quotation which is taken from Carnap's diaries, 13th of November, 1940. And Carnap says that Gödel that day has said that one should develop a formal theory of metaphysics, including such concepts as God and soul. And the answer that Carnap apparently gave to Gödel was that it would only be a non-scientific mythology and it wouldn't lead anywhere. But of course, Gödel was not satisfied. And he said that he didn't believe it. And in any case, to disprove it, one should have to try first. Right? So obviously, this is 1940. He was already thinking about something. And in June 1941, there is a first sketch that gives an idea of a proof of the existence of God using logic. And there are various notes in the Nachlass 1944 and 1954 in particular that give some improvement on that proof. And the one you see here is just one page, as you see. It's a manuscript of the 10th of February 1970, so practically 50 years ago, almost to the day, or actually 51 now. And that's the final manuscript. It's a proof using model logic. And I'm going to try to tell you quickly what this proof is about. Well, first of all, the proof goes back to an opposition that the scholastic movement had between these two people. You see Saint Anselm on the left and Saint Abelard on the right. Well, of course, you know, I say saint, you know, because for us logicians, probably the real saint is Abelard. But in truth, he was considered to be heretic. And the motto of the two theologians were opposite mottos. Anselm thought in Latin, credo ut intelligam, that is, I believe to understand. In other words, when we talk about religion, if you don't believe, you don't understand what people are talking about. And Abelard instead had something that for logicians would be more appealing and for mathematicians, intelligo ut credam, which is just the opposite. I understand to believe. That is, I cannot understand something that I don't believe. Otherwise, what kind of a belief would be that, you know, if you don't understand what you're talking about? So that's the main division. But the interesting thing is that the proof that Gödel actually wanted to mathematize was a proof by St. Anselm, which was given in the year 1077 in a little booklet, which is called Proslogion, namely a colloquium between two people. And it's what is called in theology and in philosophy, the ontological proof of the existence of God. And it was a very simple thing, actually. Anselm gave a definition of God, which is what was suggested just a few moments ago. I mean, if you say you believe or you don't believe in God, well, first of all, you have to say what you mean by God. And the strange definition that Anselm gave was that God is a being of which nothing greater can be thought. That is the greatest thing that you can think of. And the proof that God exists is that if it didn't exist, well, something bigger would be a greater thing, right? Something that existed could be a greater thing. It's not a very convincing proof, of course. And indeed, in the history of philosophy, people try to improve it. Well, of course, you know, this was the beginning of the scholastic movement, as you see, the beginning of the new millennium, right? And many centuries afterwards, Descartes, in his Discourse on the Method, 1637, actually gave a definition of God, of the essence of God, which in a sense is a reformulation of Anselm's proof. Namely, God's essence includes its own existence. God is a being that necessarily, so to speak, exists. And Spinoza in the Ethica, which is 40 years later, 1677, one of the main statements at the very beginning is the definition of a first cause. And the first cause is a being whose essence includes its own existence, again, as you see. And then I put another theologian, a modern one, namely Ratzinger, who became Pope as Benedict XVI. And in his popular book, The Introduction to Christianity, in 1968, well, he said that this is the what Descartes and Spinoza actually did is just the intended meaning of the phrase that you find in the Bible, Exodus 3:14. Remember this, because for mathematician, of course, you know, 3:14 is a magical number. So it's very appropriate that in Exodus 3:14, God says, I am that I am. And so for Ratzinger, that means I am a being whose existence, whose essence includes his own existence. So that's the beginning. This is the philosophical framework. The trouble is that I moved this and it doesn't work anymore. So what happens? Let me just see if I did something bad. Okay. All right. So in the Meditations, 1641, Descartes actually reformulated the proof in a very mathematical way, much better. And the way was the following. You have the skeleton of how a mathematical proof actually works, right? So first of all, you have to define exactly what you're talking about. And he defines God as the most perfect being, a being that has all perfections. Then you want to prove a theorem. The theorem is that God exists. Now you have a definition that God has all perfections. You want to prove the theorem that God exists. So you need an axiom. And the obvious axiom is that existence is a perfection. And the proof in that case that God exists is obvious because God has all perfections, and in particular, it has the existence, which is a perfection. So that's a beautiful little jewel, so to speak. You prove the existence of God. Of course, you wouldn't convince anybody. If you're an atheist or an agnostic, you wouldn't be convinced by such a silly proof, right? But in a sense, you know, it's a skeleton of the mathematical proof. Now, there's a trouble with the axiom, the existence is a perfection axiom. And indeed, first of all, Leibniz had some criticism to make a few years later, 1676. He wrote a little paper on the existence of the most perfect being. And he claimed that Descartes didn't prove the existence of God, but he proved that if God is possible, then it exists. So in other words, you have to show that God is possible. And how do you show it? Well, remember the definition that Descartes gave was that God is a being with all perfections. And Leibniz said, well, obviously, if you take two perfections, they go together well, that is, they're pairwise compatible, as we would say in mathematics. And hence, you see there's a question mark in there, right? Hence, since the perfections are two by two compatible, they're all compatible all together. Now, that's very suspicious, especially to a mathematician or a logician of today, right? And so this is why Gödel actually, when looked at this thing, said, aha, we have room for improvement here. But before we get to Gödel, still a few comments, because people, of course, talked about the ontological proof of the existence of God in Descartes' version, the meditation version. And in particular, Hume said, 1779, in the Dialogues of Natural Religion, attacked the notion of necessary existence. Why? Because Leibniz, in a letter, had said that Descartes not only had proved the existence of God, assuming that God was possible, then the proof of Descartes would prove not only that God exists, but that it necessarily exists. And this is what Hume commented in the Dialogues of Natural Religion, that necessary existence is a nonsense because existence is contingent by definition, right? Whatever exists, it might not exist. So you cannot talk about necessary existence. So that's a philosophical mistake, right? And Kant, of course, in the Critique of Pure Reason, he gave a lot of credit to Descartes and to Anselm previously, because he says, well, as you probably all know better than I do, most of the a good chunk of the Critique of Pure Reason is devoted to the examination of the proofs for the existence of God. And the idea of Kant is that all proofs of the existence of God actually require an ontological argument. In a sense, you know, they're ontological arguments in disguise. So the only real proof of the existence of God is the ontological proof, and that proof is wrong. Why? Well, we could rephrase comment of Kant simply in a logical language that today we accept better, namely, existence is a quantifier and is not a property. Is existence, you cannot express it in language, is an operator that, of course, we call the existential quantifier, right? So that's the mistake that Kant found or thought he found in the reasonings of Descartes and Leibniz. And Frege, coming, you know, closer to us at the end of the 1800s, 1891, there's a paper. It's one of the late papers, which is called Function and Concept. And that's a literal quotation. He says the ontological proof is defective because it considers existence as a first order concept, where instead it's a second order concept. That's a very interesting thing for logicians. We understand that we cannot, according to Frege, we cannot give a first order proof of the existence of God because we cannot talk about existence, which is more or less what Kant had said. Existence is a quantifier, it's not a property, so we cannot prove or disprove existence. We have to climb to a higher order logic, which is a second order logic. And again, you know, still related to Frege, you see that in the autobiography, Carnap, who was a student of Frege, actually followed his classes, Carnap recalls that Frege taught in his lectures the logical mistakes of the ontological proof. So actually Frege was interested in the argument, and even in classes, in logical classes, he would actually show where the mistake was. So you see that Gödel actually comes in And it follows a long series of philosophers and even logicians in thinking that it's interesting to look at proofs of the ontological proof of the existence of God, but we have to put it in a mathematically sound basis. And what he does, it was actually criticizing Leibniz's proof. Remember, you know, that the definition of God is God is a being that has all perfections, and Leibniz tried to prove that God is possible by saying, well, perfections are compatible two by two, and hence they're compatible globally altogether. And this is wrong. It's a mistake that logicians would call a mistake of compactness, right? So, for example, if you take numbers, right, if you take the property of being greater than a certain integer, for example, greater than one, greater than two, greater than three, if you take two of those properties, m and n, to be greater than m and greater than n is compatible if you are greater than the biggest one, right? So, two by two, those properties are compatible. But you cannot say that they're all compatible together, because that would mean that there is a number that is greater than all numbers. And that's, of course, impossible, right? So it's a mistake. So proof of Leibniz of necessary, of possibility, sorry, of the existence of God is wrong. And it's interesting that Gödel said not only Leibniz was wrong in this particular aspect, but Leibniz was wrong on everything. Now, that's a strong assertion, right? But Gödel also thought that Leibniz was the greatest philosopher that ever existed. So how can you put the two things together? You know, somebody that is always wrong, right, then is the greatest philosopher. And the idea of Gödel was that, well, of course, you know, nobody can be always right, right? So the best thing that you can do is to be sometimes right and sometimes wrong. But all of us are able to be sometimes right and sometimes wrong. So short of being always right, which is impossible, the next best thing is to be always wrong. Because if you're always wrong, you know, then you just change assertions with negations and you get all the truth, right? So that tells you the way, the strange way that Gödel's mind actually worked. So what is the ontological proof in the version of Gödel? Well, it's a definition again, but since you cannot say that God has all perfections because you don't know what a perfection is, well, Gödel would just say God is a being that has all positive properties. Now, you don't know what perfections are, but what is a positive property? Ah, positive property is something like positive numbers, right? Only instead of being numbers, you consider properties. So you have a sequence of axioms, some of them very, very obvious, and most of them actually quite obvious, which are thought in accordance to the properties of positive numbers. So, for example, positive properties are pairwise compatible, as Leibniz would actually say. And in the example that I just gave, you know, if you take two numbers, right, to have if you have two numbers, well, of course, to multiply two numbers, you still get a positive number, right? So that's the axiom one. Being God is a positive property. The empty property is not positive. A property that is not satisfied by anything is not positive. If a property is not positive, then its negation must be positive. And then if a property is positive, the extension of that property is still positive. You may not be convinced by those axioms, and of course, you know, they may look at you, to you as quite random, right? But of course, you know, would be a little more complicated to try to justify them nowadays, right? Also, because Gödel was working in a framework of model logic, right? So his reasonings were kind of complex. But as you see here, you know, just a few comments. Gödel's proof, original proof, was a version of Leibniz's proof, and he actually wanted to prove what Leibniz claimed, namely that God exists necessarily. And of course, to be able to prove that something exists necessarily, you need a model logic with the necessity operator. And then he used a logic, unfortunately, which was too strong. It was a model logic, but in that logic, necessary and true actually collapsed. This was discovered only later on. So, of course, you know, it was kind of a mistake. But the interesting thing is that if necessity and truth collapse, then you can just discharge and discard all the modalities in Gödel's proof, and you can just reformulate it into a proof in normal logic, right? And for some reasons, I don't know why nobody ever thought of doing this, but when there was the meeting in 2006, the anniversary, centennial anniversary of Gödel's birth, there was a giant meeting in Vienna, and you see here some of the people who participated. You see Cohen, the only logician actually the only person who worked in logic that got a Fields Medal. You see Kreisel on the right top. On the bottom right, there is Pfefferman. And there was even Kasparov, the chess champion, who was interested in mathematics. So we were all there, and I had the good luck of being there. And what I did, I just gave a proof of the existence of God in the manner of Gödel, but using just normal notions of first-order logic without any modalities. And what this amounts to in just one word, for those of you who understand the notion, is that the set of positive properties is just an ultra filter, right? So that was just an observation and nothing more. But at the meeting, there was also Harvey Friedman. So we talked about this proof, right? And he was interested in this. And a few years later, you see, 2012, he sent me a paper which was called A Divine Consistency Proof for Mathematics. And what did he do? Well, you know that the existence of certain kinds of ultrafilters, in particular those that are called countably complete ultrafilters, closed under countable intersection, is actually a strong infinity axiom, which implies the existence of big numbers, big Cantor numbers, transfinite numbers, which are called measurable cardinals. Now, it's known in logic that if you assume the existence of a measurable cardinal, then you can prove the consistency of set theory. So you cannot prove the existence, if you want to put it the other way, you cannot prove the existence of measurable cardinals inside set theory, because otherwise you would prove the consistency of the theory and you would go against Gödel's theory, right? So what Friedman did was to turn things upside down. That is, he decided to define God as the intersection of a complete, uncountably complete ultra filter. So it's a stronger notion of God than the one that Gödel did. Gödel defined God as the intersection of the ultra filter of the positive properties, right? Which is just a normal ultra filter. But if you actually, instead of taking just a normal ultra filter, you take an uncountably complete ultra filter, then you have a stronger notion of God, and you can prove the consistency of mathematics. So this is a beautiful thing. And in a later paper, actually, Friedman actually showed that it's possible to use a countably complete ultra filter of definable sets. And he calls them angels, you know, so this is a little lower in degrees. But still, you know, just using the existence of angels, you can prove the consistency of mathematics. So the final observation is, you remember that Hermann Weyl in the 1930s, I think, he said, you know, that God exists because mathematics is consistent and the devil exists because we cannot prove it, right? But now, actually, using Friedman's work, we can actually prove that God exists because mathematics is consistent. So that's exactly what the notion of God defined in the way of Friedman would provide. And of course, you know, we cannot, and the devil exists because we cannot prove the consistency. And that's the final slide. Did Gödel actually believe in his proof? Or if you want to phrase it differently, what did Gödel believe in? And there are a few letters in the collected works, the fourth and the fifth volumes of Gödel's collected works are the epistolary. And there are four letters on religion to his mother of the 60s. There is Kreisel's obituary. Kreisel was a close friend of Gödel for many years, and he had discussions on this topic with him. And there are also the conversations that Hao Wang, a philosopher, a Chinese Chinese origins, that worked, I think, at Harvard, that talked with Gödel in the 80s and 90s. And we discovered that God believed in everything, that Gödel believed in everything, not only in God, that you know, his notion of God was more like Leibniz than Spinoza. Einstein instead believed in a notion of God that was closer to Spinoza. But he actually believed in afterlife. He believed in spirits. He was interested and believer in parapsychology, in telepathy. And of course, he also believed in sets and concepts, which is, of course, makes him an idealist, right? So that's the end of it, so to speak. You know, Gödel didn't need proofs to believe in God. And the reason he reframed the ontological proof in mathematical terms, it was just because he wanted to correct the mistake that Leibniz had done. And the end of this is just a final slide. Those are two books that I published, unfortunately, in Italian. One is a biography of Gödel, in which I did put a chapter on his proof of the existence of God. And on the left, instead, this is an edited work. There's the original paper by Gödel, and then a collection of essays by a number of other people discussing this. So that was what I wanted to say. And I think I took my half an hour. So I better stop and leave you with the other talk, unless there are questions for me.
Yeah, thank you very much, Professor Rodi Fredi.
Thank you.
Italian is very good, so it's no problem. yes, we have a few minutes for comments and questions. So
okay.
Referring to your first remark about Gödel's name, we can say that God is in Gödel when we ask, is there God? Yes,
in the name of God, yeah. In the name of Gödel, we could found a religion, you know, with whose creed would be, you know, I believe in Gödel.
Yeah. and a question is, where is it possible to be a logical, mathematical Platonist and not believe in God? I think if you are a Platonist, somehow you finally have to...
I understand. Well, it all depends kind of on how you define the notion of God, of course. Because one thing is metaphysics. Of course, you know, if you're a Platonist, then you believe in metaphysics, and in particular, you might believe in sets and in big sets, you know, large cardinals and so on. So there is a stratification of beliefs. You should talk to Ali, of course, who is the expert on set theory, right? So there are many religions which are compatible one to the with the other, mostly because the cardinal axioms are usually put in a linear order, right? But this is still not believing in God, because at least in Christianity, God is a personal being.
Sure.
So unless you believe that there is a set which is also a person, right, then it wouldn't be a religion. But certainly, I mean, I'm not a believer. I don't believe in the existence of sets, right? So
but this is another interesting question, because...
Compatible but independent positions, I would say.
Yeah, but it was interesting also that when we talk about believing in sets, what came to my mind was Thomas Aquinas, who defined angels as forms. Yeah, so the angel is, or even a species. An angel is one species. The form is a species with one element only, yeah? So in fact, it was an idea of an angel as a set, let's say. But just a comment. Are there any questions? Because we are ready to have some time also for questions and answers. No? Okay, so maybe later. And thank you very much again, Professor Rodi Fredi. It was very interesting.
And have a nice continuation and happy Gödel's Day and World Logic Day.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.